everyone. We're actually going to construct our garment. We're going to get started by setting up our machine. And everybody always has a lot of questions. What kind of machine do I need? What do you recommend? I'm not in the, well, you need the fanciest machine out there. You need a good machine that's in good working order and has a few basic stitches. And you'll find these on all machines, whether it's a Brother or, in this case, a Singer or Pfaff or etc. You want to make sure you have a straight stitch. And the straight stitch also has a reverse stitch. This is going to allow you to lock your seams at the beginning and ending of your stitching so that they don't separate. You want a zigzag stitch. Zigzag stitch can be used in place of a overlock stitch like a serger uses on stretch fabrics. Some of them have what's called a stretch stitch. It looks like a straight stitch, but it's actually a combination of straight stitches that are done next to each other so that if you're sewing a stretchy fabric, the seam can stretch, the threads won't break if you put stress or tension on the stitching. You also want, on older machines, it was called a satin stitch. Usually it's a buttonhole stitch. It's a zigzag stitch, but it's very close together, so it makes a nice little ribbon of stitching. Those are the stitches that you need. You want to make sure that your tension is set for the fabric that you're stitching. Now, my machine and a lot of the newer machines, it's automatic. I actually just have to stitch on a little bit of scrap fabric, and the machine will internally decide what tension it needs to be at to receive an even stitch. An even stitch is one where the top thread and the bottom thread meet in the middle of the seam between the two layers of fabric. If you're seeing thread above the fabric and you're stitching, then that means the lower tension is too loose. If you're seeing your top thread coming through on the bottom of your stitching, then that means that one's too loose. And what it means is if your machine's not automatic, you may have to kind of adjust that a little bit. So I always say keep your scrap fabric handy and adjust that until you have it the way you want it. For my machine, I have I call it the gas pedal, but I do have the option of stitching, just pushing the buttons on the front of the machine. For this demonstration, I'll be using my gas pedal so I can use both my hands. We need to put a foot on this machine for one. I'm using this one. It's pretty much a universal foot. It is clear, and I like that because I can actually see my fabric going through the machine. So if I'm on a curve or a kind of a detail area, a corner, and I have to make sure that I'm very precise, I can actually see my needle through this foot. It also has a little notch so that when it's here and my needle's sewing straight in the center, I can kind of guide my fabric using that. It does have a little slit here, and that's so that the thread can go from the needle through the foot and out the back. And for this one, it's really easy to install the foot. I basically just line it up and it clips on. There's a little lever back here, and if you push it, it releases it so you can change it out. If you're going to be doing a lot of garment sewing or that, or you want to use piping or cording or trims or that, I would recommend you get a zipper foot, and I can go over that in another video when we might need that. It just makes sewing a little bit easier. For this machine, the bobbin goes here, but we need to put thread on the bobbin. Some machines you can just drop the bobbin in the bottom and push a couple of adjustments and it'll spin it. This one, it's not set up that way. This one's set up more like some of your older, more traditional machines, where we have to fill the bobbin with thread from the top. Now, a key thing for success in sewing, if you do get a used machine or you want to have more bobbins full of thread, make sure you get the right bobbin for your machine. If you get a bobbin that is not meant for your machine, what can happen is the thread will kink and catch, and it'll make literally a bird's nest of thread in the bottom of your sewing machine and could potentially damage your machine. So when you see these packages of the bobbins in the store, make sure you're getting the one that's for your machine. So to thread this one, we have a spindle up here with a little lever, and that just kind of fits up there. My machine has a spool holder up here in the back, so I need to put my thread. Oh, the Guterman threads, I like these spools because this little piece down here, it has these little notches. And what that does is you can actually take the thread off the spool when you're done sewing and wind it back and then feed it between this little ridge and the bottom of the spool, and it holds it in place. So you don't have a box with spools of thread with dangling threads hanging off of them. But I also have to remember this little piece here when I'm putting it on the spindle, because the thread is going to pull away from the spool this way, and if I put it this way, it might get caught on that side. So thread my spool onto my spool holder, and you usually have a variety of these little things. They're, if you see the center, it actually kind of reminds me of like the old things they used to put in 45 records. And it's just a little thing. It slides onto the pin and holds your thread in place. And if you notice, it's also kind of conical shape a little bit. And that just helps the thread kind of slide over it so it won't get caught. Now, every machine's different on how you thread it and how you thread your bobbin. You want to refer to your owner's manual, or if it's a used machine, a lot of the manuals are now online, so you can find a manual that matches your machine. And this one, I come down here, loop around this one. Now your bobbin has a hole in it. And that little hole, we want to slide our thread through. So if you can see, the thread is actually now going through the bobbin, up through the hole, so when it winds, it's going to wind on that center post. And this one, to engage it, we slide it over. This little thing should fit between the two blades. And I usually hang on to this for a little bit, because sometimes when this thing's spinning, if I'm not holding this, it'll just spin it right off the thread. I'm gonna turn my machine on. Now my machine, when I move this, engage it over, it automatically knows we're winding the bobbin. Some machines you have to adjust a knob or that to disengage the belt that drives the needle up and down. So this one, I step on the gas, give it a few turns. I've wound the thread on the post enough that it shouldn't slip off. Hopefully. And I'm just gonna fill my bobbin. Now, depending on the size of the project, I might fill this all the way, I might fill it halfway, might just put a little bit on there, but I want to get at least a third of the way full. We're just doing this today, so that's probably good. So yeah, it's about a third to a half. I'm gonna undo this. Now I'm gonna thread my machine, and again, like I said, some machines are different. Most of the Singers follow the same path. It's gonna come down, up and around, and they've got numbers on here too, so don't panic. This one also has diagrams up here at the top for winding the bobbin and for threading it. Down here by our needle, there's this little spring. It kind of looks like a paper clip sticking out. My thread needs to go under it. That's the last guide. And I'm gonna cut, give myself about 6 to 8 inches here. Now, this machine does have a quote unquote needle threader. As you can tell from the dust, I don't use this because half the time I spend 3 or 4 tries trying to get the thread to go through the needle. And you want to make sure that you're feeding your needle so that the thread is coming from the front to the back. You want to make sure you don't loop it or catch it under the point of the needle. And the top thread is threaded. Now we need to install our bobbin. Again, machines differ. This one, I have to manually thread the bobbin. There's a notch here, so I have to hold the bobbin and pull it until it catches under that little piece. I'm going to lay it back here. And I need to get this thread to come underneath the plate And through this little hole that's through here, this little slit, these are feed dogs. These push the fabric, and these are feed dogs. They push the fabric under. So I'm gonna hold that. Since I've pushed this back over, my machine automatically defaults to a straight stitch. Needle in the center, and stitch length. So I'm just gonna hand crank, send it down. And now my bottom thread is pulled up a little loop. I can take my scissors, something, and just kind of catch it and slide it out. Okay, and pull my threads to the back. And the machine's threaded. My machine has a little plate that needs to go over the bottom. Some of them are metal. I actually like this one because it's clear, so I can actually see when I'm running out of thread. Because when you get down and you can kind of see the post, you want to go ahead and take that out and refill it. Sometimes I actually have another bobbin already threaded and ready to go, especially if I'm sewing a lot of the same item in one day. Now for needles, these are just like hand sewing needles as far as what needle you want to use. We have what is a universal needle. It's kind of narrow, it's sort of sharp but not very sharp, and it's generally a good all-purpose needle. You do want to change these out from time to time because just like a sewing needle, when you're sewing by hand, they do get dull. And when that happens, you'll just have a mess. It won't want to sew through the fabric. You'll get knots and little bird's nests forming on your machine, that kind of thing. Now, earlier we went and pinned all of our pockets in place. Generally, when you're sewing, you want the majority of your piece to the left of the needle and your seam allowance to the right of the needle. This one has a large base. Some of them just have a small square base. This one's actually meant for quilters because they usually are working on very large pieces and they're very heavy, so it just kind of helps them push the quilt over. I like it because it just gives me a lot of space for my hands and I can kind of keep my tiny pieces over here ready to go. Now, I practice what is called chain piecing, and that's something I kind of picked up from quilting too. Chain piecing is basically you sew one piece, when that clears the machine, you pick up the next piece and keep going until you've finished all the pieces that are the same. For my stitch length on my machine says 2.5. I like to go a little bit smaller or shorter stitch length on doll clothes because we tended to be using a smaller seam allowance and our curves are a lot smaller, so I want my stitches closer together so I'm getting a nice clean curve, a clean edge. So I usually put mine about 2.0. Sometimes I'll even go lower. A lot of machines you can actually change the needle position. That's actually quite handy, and this one I can really adjust it all the way from far right to far left. And see, it beeped twice to let me know I've gone too far. For a zigzag stitch, the stitch width actually determines how far it goes right or left. On a straight stitch, it's not going to shift this way. The stitches are going to be this way, but when you change your stitch width, you can actually sew a little closer or a little further away from the edge of your fabric. And I'll explain a little bit. This is primarily for quilting and patchwork. So my quarter inch is marked on my machine. There's a little edge cut here and this line cut here. But say on this, we want to do an eighth of an inch. I can actually move my needle closer to this guide. 4.5. And measure, and then I know that when I'm stitching, it's actually going to be an eighth of an inch from this line, even though I'm using this as a guide. I know everybody's seen these in the sewing kits. C asked me what this was for. It's called a gauge. We use it for a lot of different things. It's got a little slider here with a point and a pin or a hole. And there's a hole here. This one's actually gotten kind of broken off, but there should be a matching point on this side in a corner here. You can actually use this when you're doing hems, as you're folding. And you can put it on, say I wanted a 1-inch hem, I set it here. And you can follow along, but you can also use it as kind of like a caliper to measure things. So I'm gonna lower my needle by hand, kind of see where it's gonna go in the fabric. Now I know that this piece right here, this line, usually lines up with the inside of this foot. And I can actually measure to see if that's an eighth of an inch, and it is. I usually try to hang on to these a little bit so they don't slide down in there for the first stitch. Some people use a small piece of scrap material to stitch through first and kind of pull on that. But we're just gonna go ahead and attach our pocket to our pant pieces. And again, that's just gonna be an eighth of an inch, but I'm gonna use this 1/4-inch stitch guide. Because this seam is gonna be captured by another seam, in other words, we're gonna sew this and then sew across it perpendicular, I'm not gonna back stitch. I'm just gonna sew straight. Now remember I pulled those pins. I just pull those out as we go along. They're away from the needle. You do not want to sew over a pin. And I'm going a couple of stitches beyond the pocket. I'm just going to slide that over. If you can look, I started a couple of stitches before the pocket, sewed across the pocket, and then a couple of stitches after. And with our chain piecing, I'm just going to pull that back so it clears the foot and do our next one. So we've sewn our pockets through our side seams, and you may ask, well, why didn't we just cut the pocket out when we cut out the side of the pants? This gives us the opportunity, if we were using a dark fabric or a fabric that had like a metallic finish, something that might stain the doll, this gives us the opportunity to use something that would not stain the doll for the inside of the pockets. Like you could use a lighter fabric or one that's color fast. That way they can stick their hands in the pockets and you don't have to worry about the color transferring on. A big thing about a side seam pocket though is you do want to try to use something that will either coordinate with the fabric or match the background color of the fabric if it's really dark, because these side seam pockets, when the doll does have its hand in the pocket, you will see a portion of the inside of the pocket at the back. So our next step is to press the pocket open. And what they mean is they want you to press the seam, just kind of stick your fingers in, and it'll say finger press. Especially with cottons, this is pretty easy. You just basically just run your finger over that seam until it starts to fold back. Now when somebody says press something, press it. There's usually a very good reason. In this case, we want to make sure that it lays flat so that when we do put the two pieces together and make the pouch pocket, that the seam is still flat and straight. And we have our back, we've got a front, and we're going to put these right sides together. Well, might help if I had the right front. Right back. Okay. And when I pin these for the long seams like this, I usually start at the ends, make sure that they meet, and then work my way towards that pocket. Remember this mark? This is where we're going to stop our stitching and then continue on around the pocket. I tried to pin on the side, so that I'm always doing my seam so that the majority of the fabric's on this side and the seam allowance is on this side. Now for this one, because this one will not have a seam, this will have top stitching but will not have a seam that intersects the seam line here. So for this one, when I'm sewing down this seam, I will want to use the back stitch to lock the seam at either end so the pieces don't separate when we're trying to attach them later. And this one is a quarter of an inch. So when we do this, we want to put the fabric so that it's just behind the needle. In this case, just past that hole where the needle goes. And on this machine, and then I'm going to grab these threads back here, which kind of helps me push this along. We're going to come to our first dot, and we're going to stop. And we're going to bring our needle down so that it's just through the fabric. And we're going to rotate around. And then we're going to sew around our curve. Take curve slowly. Different machines have different pivot points. And as you see, what I'm doing is I'm leaving the machine so that the needles just pierce the fabric. I lift my presser foot slightly and then rotate it back around. Pick a few stitches. And repeat. We don't want to pull the fabric because remember that's a bias edge and it'll stretch out our pocket. We want to try to keep it flat. Okay, now sometimes I have to kind of watch because we're sewing through some bulk here. Drop it down. I need to come one more stitch. Now we're going to come down to this mark. That's the bottom mark on the seam for the pocket. I'm going to stop and pivot back and continue the rest of the seam. Do not stitch over pins. I'm gonna stop just shy of the fabric clearing the machine, and I'm gonna lock that stitch. I'm gonna take this one out so you can see. It will not open at the top. And we've got a nice seam with a little pocket in there. And we're just gonna repeat the process for the second one. This one will be going in the opposite direction. This one I want to come up to at least this point. And then start my pocket. When the fabric starts to do this, that's when you definitely know you need to readjust. This is really important if you were sewing a princess seam on the front of a dress, because if you let it pucker up like that, you won't get a good straight seam on the front of the dress. It'll start to pucker and be out of shape. We've joined the fronts to the backs and made our little pocket in the side seam. And it may seem a little low, that's because we have a lot of waistline material that's going to be folded over to make that deep waist.